selecting himself from the rest of the anthropologists and from real people. His work may not be discussed here. He has provided a photo copy, but unfortunately, he doesn't need to do this work. And then, to understand the role, we did not expect someone to be about already on my slides. The most important of the seminar is to do with feminist methodologies in French. I think the best way to deal with this great field was to present before you a selection of examples of work of women artists dealing with the construct of the feminine gender. The works I have chosen are international, and there is great diversity in the construction of the feminine gender, which is portrayed. I have deliberately chosen to keep the focus of this talk international. The reason for this is that I feel it would be interesting to bring before you the work I have been exposed to by living in England. The work of women artists in Pakistan has already been dealt with in depth by Selina. The two women artists, Laila Maria Pacheco and Kona Rego, whose work I will discuss, have been selected with special attention to their emerging importance as proponents of feminist art in the Western art world. The issues which govern the work of these artists are those of gender, captivity, myth and magic, women and power, against a background of religiosity. The paintings and etchings of Pacheco and Rego deal with images cut from folk tales, childhood stories, childhood experiences, and prayers. I began this talk with a discussion of my own work, where I attempt to portray issues of gender, women and power, while using the medium of myth, magic, and symbolism. In traditional Western art, there was a stereotypical construction of womanhood. The commonly accepted images of women, as outlined by women, were the raging and horror archetypes, which restricted any other impressions and viewpoints. To be revealed or reviled by the male gaze was the fate of women. I would like to present the rest of this paper against the background of a few examples which typify this traditional portrayal. This is a collection of drawings of four different models, all of whom were intimate friends of the artist, Gramsci, Camilla Rossetti. In Rossetti's work, his sister, Christina Rossetti, herself a painter and poet of some repute, wrote an appointed record in an artist's studio. One face looks out from all his canvases. On self-same figure, six of odds or leans, not as she is, but as she paints his dream. These drawings are not about capturing the essence of the individual's womanhood. They are significant in that they belong to the process of redefinition of woman, where she is seen as an image, as visibly different from the real life woman of the 1850s. I would like to juxtapose this painting drawings with the following slide. These are advertisements for cosmetic products. The last two faces may appear familiar, Gabriel Guerrero and Marlene Dietrich. All that the faces have in common is that the features that may have lent individuality to their owners have been carefully airbrushed over, leaving only overemphasized hair, lips, and eyes. This is so as not to disturb or disrupt the male gaze at whom this campaign is directed, even though what is being marketed is supposed to be for the use and benefit of women. My next slide is a photograph taken in 1948 by Robert Guénon, titled "A Bleak Look." This portrait of Vera is hidden, very alive inside the shop, and is complicit in the triangulation of looks between a man gazing at the fetishized woman in the painting on the left. His wife who cannot see this painting and is looking at something we cannot see. Therefore, IBS 2 is directed at the painting of a nude woman. Both the women are passive in their roles, but the gaze of the wife has been mediated, even though she is placed in the center of the composition and is the figure who is noticed first. Her presence adds to the spice of the situation, enhancing the fatal quality of the man's look. Not surprisingly, a painting where the woman is less passive has been painted by a woman. A painting completed in 1879 by Erika Sant. We see the woman in the painting looking away from the spectator into the distance. But as the spectator follows her gaze, another look is revealed, that of the man with the upright glasses, steadily fixed on the woman in the foreground. So the painting just juxtaposes two looks, giving priority to that of the woman who at least is actively looking. She does not return the spectator's gaze, which confirms the viewer's right to look and to appraise. Instead, a connection is established between the spectator outside the frame between blacks and white students. These are some examples of the stereotyping of women that dominated traditional Western art, albeit there were exceptions. This could be seen from slide 2. The stereotyping was not only present in the pirates, but also extended to advertising, and Europe has been pointed out there were exceptions. Given the themes that I have chosen, shown examples from, it was men who dominated the production of both fine art and advertising. As women artists have come into their own, they have brought minor representations of women into art. It is to these artists that we are doing. If you would look at your photocopies. The Brazilian painter, Jeffrey's work is truly the images of the powerful women of the Bible. Judith, Salome, Democritus. Allusions to the spirits, a female creature puzzling the minds of men, yet guarding the secret of her being, are to be seen frequently in her work. The image of the burning woman who was sent to stage, often in a circus-like setting, but in a throwback to childhood, with the shadows and the tones of manipulation in power. The agents of the god woman are large, furry, rodent-like creatures with sharp teeth and nails, drawn among the chariots fetching from wicker baskets. Great plumes of magician's smoke, clouds areas of the surface through which you can see eyes watching and ears listening, like a silent door cover at night. Next time, just as people begin to drop in the animals that they keep in our households, the victim, in this case the blind woman, adopts the mannerisms of her oppressors. From the whole grown up and rural culture to paint Western tapestry, there were a series of questions about from national arts are disturbing and disquieting. Many are to do with domestic scenes, as in her paintings, where the woman of the house looms larger than everyone around her. She is the puppet master, making them all dance to her tune. In Polly with the Kettle Lamb, Polly is shown as a large, buxom woman, with not small children, but small men, seated at her table in one of her lap, all waiting to be served. Yet it is she who is the master or mistress, or it is she who will learn out the eats. In Methodologies, the old woman who lived in the shoe, we see the old woman patiently standing in a helpless way while those who watch us look on and don't help. The image of Mother Netherlands, associated with happy memories of unbelonging childhood in the safe care of Peter Pan, has a nightmarish quality. Captain Hook is drawn as a skull, being pushed in a temple by his minions, while the docile mermaids of the original story covert unashamedly with a bone, pointing to a latent sexuality. Wendy is a marionette-like figure, helplessly watching, while Peter Pan is a mere speck in the distance. The subversive and disturbing quality of these etchings will endure, and it is the most realized that you'll ever see in this time. Scenes dealing with families and the family, these are the core of Rego's work. Again, I hope women imagine and women in our own busy and domestic tasks. What is strange is that ostensibly the women are engaged upon tasks serving their men who remain supreme. But the women are at times malevolent, or at all times powerful. The viewer is left to wonder whether the male intends to be so, or how the situation went out of their control. The tradition of storytelling is indeed a primary gift, important to primal states of life, to the old world before books, to old and non-literate societies, and therefore to childhood forever. For Rego, the presence of women in her life when she was a child, mother, aunts, grandmothers, and women living at home were all her storytellers. Women thus became the villains of tales which were to inform her work. The thread my work shares with that of Pacheco and Rego is that I too use legends and myths as sources for my work. Like them, I don't simply reenact these stories in my work, but use their imagery to identify my contemporary themes. The issues that have underpinned and directed my work within the disciplines of painting and printmaking are those of gender, myth, magic, religion, symbolism, and power. My purpose is not to demystify religion, magic, and related myths, but to use these symbols of a mass language and visual vocabulary to develop themes in my work. Work at university and up to the present has led to the attempt to destroy the stereotyping of women. My attempt is to show an eventual regrouping of women in a coordinated effort to combat imposed perceptions. The figures are recognizably figures of women. Amongst the distinguishing features, they have mutilated limbs, amorphous and one personlessness are now recognition as individuals. In short, in a more anonymous presence. As my work develops, these new triggers took on an androgynous form in order to disguise any erotic appeal that may remain. When these androgynous figures, the comment was directed out rather than in toward themselves. The way works, magic and enchantment, established a link with mythologies and history. In particular, I used the vehicle of myth to construct a visual and historical connection with past legends. The purpose of this is not to reenact those tales, but to use them as vehicles for redefining contemporary issues and attitudes towards struggle, inequality, and injustice. The serve as catalysts for ideas and images based on fully evolving paper and canvas, painted nostalgia in the sense of deja vu in the viewer, but not directly to media references or open artist's first impressions. For example, the legend of Leela and the Swan gave rise to images of power exerted by one human being over another, while beings became an iconographic element in many readings and paintings. Myths used as words for our daily existence is not a natural or new phenomenon. If we consider that it was these fables that were woven around the stereotyped traits and characteristics of the past men and women, and the many within our collective memory. The legends later came to be classified as personifications of those traits and characteristics, so much so that they became synonymous with them. This exists in our collective history. The various forms of ritual and Far Eastern imagery, with its particular emphasis on monochromatic palettes and economy of learning, was another source of credit to my work. My preoccupation with conformist rituals, peculiar to institutionalized religions, religious, and their attendant mysteries, led me to think about religion or any institution which conducts its passages adhering to strict rules, form a position of invincible authority. I do realize the importance and existence of the various rituals created to counter the establishment, but the focus of my work has been conformist rituals. I see institutions as excluding devices, which could be very often and potentially threatening to the individual. The context in which I use these elements is to define the trance-like states within which the endogenous forms are trapped. Symbols of encapsulated space, like the circle in my work, refers to the constrained lives of human beings. It also refers to the ritual involved in setting aside a particular hallowed space, for example, the tradition of worshiping shrines in the subcontinent. This has no basis in reality, only in myth. The space the circle inhabits encompasses both the sun and the moon, regarded as male and female respectively in mythologies, and is also a reference to the dichotomous existence of the sexes. The circle also indicates the role of a colonial nature, the cycle of the cycle of life and death as nature of the female is a life carrier. But it is also a tremendous potential to overthrow with a view to reconstruct, but should be recognized again as a reference to women's colonial roots. So while the work shows mutilated female and androgynous figures, they are possessed of a native rebelliousness. This two-age role that woman plays emphasizes the gap between myth as a reality we would like to believe in and the actual nature of the situation. The presence of the river signifies a primarily mystical body representative of time, change, and enchantment. It is also used as a connecting thread of color to find parts distinctive lifelike outline through the panels of the diptychs and triptychs. The precise format of the diptych and triptych is also meant as a reference to the beginnings and endings in the lifetime of any individual. The leaf and flower motifs are used as symbols of solutions, which may be threatening to individuals and indicative of a fate that will finally overwhelm them. The self-reflecting world of illusion, which decided the fate of narcissists, as well as the ritual involved in the gathering of various herbs into the night of the full moon, populated with human terms and certain salvation rituals tended in our sources for these images. We use symbolic battle fields to enact the ever-continuing power struggles between the sexes. The resultant cycles of change and metamorphosis reinforce the underlying connection between the nature of earth and woman. In the final reckoning, I see women emerging as complete and more individuals, only when their diverse and distinct facets